Howdy folks! Welcome back to the Steampunk Desperado channel. I'm your host, Vaughn Troide, and I am the Steampunk Desperado. The purpose of this channel is, of course, steampunk, that wonderful genre of science fiction that combines historical elements with technological greatness. Much of it takes place in the Victorian era with gears and cogs and steam power, that sort of thing, but we have a lot more variety in settings and so on. In general, the historical element is what sets it off. So today we're going to talk about one of those very fictional works that incorporates some very interesting historical elements in a very unique way. This is an anime. And again, we do a lot of anime on here because Japanese animation is not just for children. And a lot of it is aimed at adults. And that's very interesting stories, some very very clever ideas, and it often broaches topics that you don't see in Western works of fiction because of the different cultural perspective. In any case, this anime we're talking about today is called Last Exile, and it's, strictly speaking, it's not steampunk, it's actually dieselpunk, which is another variant, which stylistically, steampunk is Victorian era, it's steam power, it's gears, it's goggles, it's that sort of thing. And dieselpunk is a little bit farther in the future when diesel power supplanted, or a little bit less far in the past rather, when diesel power supplanted steam power. And you have things like 1930s pilots, Amelia Earhart type of thing. It's almost like it's into the Indiana Jones era. That sort of thing. So it's an adventure, it's got this historical feel, but it's a little different than steampunk. It's a little bit more gritty, it's a little bit more modern. Anyway, Last Exile is dieselpunk in the sense of its style. It's got kind of a 1920s and 30s style to the people, the costumes, and the technology. Although there's some interesting futuristic elements thrown in there. This is an anime that was by a guy named Koichi Chigera, I hope I'm pronouncing his name correctly, and it was first broadcast in a double season in 2003, and only later made into a manga, which is the reverse of the usual situation. Usually you have the graphic, the paper form first, and then it becomes an anime. And it's something that I discovered, and I had kind of a mixed feelings about it. I consider it a masterpiece, but a flawed masterpiece. It's got a number of issues I've got with it, so it may not be for everybody, but I still loved it nonetheless. Dieselpunk, as I said, has the 20s and 30s style. In this case, the central technology of the film is magnetic levitation airships. It's kind of a mysterious technology done, which is based on a type of fluid or fuel called Claudia, which is, interestingly enough, is also the name of their monetary system, monetary unit. Anyway, so it's very old looking. It's like there's a lot of chrome and rounded lines and so on. They're like, you know, a 1930s Hudson Hawk that flies. And because of the levitation technology, you don't have to worry about wings because it stays in the air without them, and it's not lighter than air either, so they can be reasonably fast. Now, the historical elements, besides the stylistic elements of the machinery and so on, the way they look and the way that it's mechanical and people work on them with wrenches and this Claudia fluid, maybe it's a little bit like diesel fuel, except it makes you fly. The costuming is historical, and there's a lot of military conflict involved, and the uniforms and the structure evokes the Napoleonic Wars, which is a little bit before the Victorian period, early 1800s. And then there are different styles that go all the way up to Victorian, a little bit past, almost World War I. The main characters are, and as in a lot of animes, there's two teenagers, Klaus Falke and Lavi Head, boy and girl. Not brother and sister, but they act like brother and sister. They were orphaned as young children, and they've survived by becoming couriers using the aircraft that belonged to their late fathers because it's magnetic it's no more difficult to fly than driving a car. So it makes it a little bit believable. And so I found this, I first encountered this doing a search of steampunk related anime, and the look of the still that they used in the Wikipedia article kind of put me off. It was like so cutesy looking. I thought, can this possibly be good? And finally came back to it, and yes, it is good. But the cutesy thing is, it does take a little bit of getting used to, because it's a lot of, like a lot of anime, it's a mixed bag. The setting is a fantasy world, like a lot of the steampunk, but it's also far future in the sense that this is a human space colony that regressed to an earlier technology. And they've got issues with the environment. There's a lot of problems finding fresh water and so on. That's one of the central themes of the show. The fantasy world of Prester has these two human nations. They were colonized by people from Earth, and they're cut off from Earth now for many centuries. And the countries are called Anatare and Disith. They always have interesting names for these things. And there's also a high-tech people called the Guild, and they almost look a little elf-like because they've got kind of pointy ears, and they're very decadent, and they're very high-tech, and they kind of look over all the rest, look down at everybody else, and they're the only ones that understand the technology, the magnetic technology, and it's almost like a kind of a feeling of Dune. Like, these people are like the Guild, and they have this monopoly on higher technology, which makes it interesting, kind of a cyberpunkish feel. Now, the whole show is just visually beautiful. It's amazing. The style and the setting and the people, the costumes, the machinery all have this wonderful look. It's just fantastic. Now, Klaus and Lavi, again, they look young. I mean, they're teenagers, but they kind of look like they're about 10, but they are teenagers. And they fly their ship delivering messages and so forth, because apparently communications isn't as advanced or that regressed further. And they do a lot of work with these military airships because there's a war going on between Disith and Anatare. And they end up befriending this young girl called Alvis, and she turns out to be this princess who has these magical powers, and they have to protect her. Everybody wants to capture her. They end up on this rogue airship. And these airships are kind of like old-fashioned steampunk airships, since they're huge. They're like battle cruisers of the sky. And again, they're magnetic, so they just kind of float. And so they end up on this ship called the Sylvana, which doesn't seem to belong to any nation, and it just attacks other ships for whatever reason. The captain is this broody, pretty boy called Alex Rowe, and his first in command is the executive officer, Sophia, who just happens to be a princess. How she ended up on this, I don't know. But there's a lot of other people. There's an infantry, basically, on board ship. And these soldiers line up with their long guns, and they shoot at the other airships. They basically open up and shoot at the other airships, and they're shooting each other in rows. Like in the Napoleonic War, which is interesting. And there are a lot of women in this military, mostly support roles, less so in infantry. And unlike some of the more politically correct things like the recent Star Wars, they are all pretty. All of them are just gorgeous. And the show is, like as I said, is wonderful, but there's some kind of odd plot holes. For example, one of the things about this world is that they have this layer of violent winds called the Grand Stream, and you have to cross it in order to get between these two nations. And in fact, that's how the Klaus and Lavi's fathers died in a mission where they had to cross the Grand Stream. And yet, for some reason, these two nations are fighting. Now, if it's so difficult to cross the Grand Stream, why are they fighting? How do they even get across without their airships being wrecked? I'm not sure. It's never really explained. Another plot hole, and there's others besides these, but these are the major ones, is how the Sylvana came to be. Who is Alex Rowe? Who is he angry at? And how did the princess of Anatare, the heir to the throne, end up being his his second in command. And why does Anatare later accept her back when her father dies? Why do they later accept her as their queen? When she's kind of been in rebellion against them, almost like treason. And yet for some reason they forgive her. Now, another interesting thing about this show is there's a lot of contrast between the very cutesy characters, some of them very childlike, and some of the, well, there's a more adult-looking characters, and some very beautiful female characters, and then the violence behind the scenes, all the war going on and so forth. And it's none of it's explicit, which is nice, so it's suitable for kids, not maybe real young kids probably wouldn't understand it, but it's in generally okay. And it's got kind of a Star Wars feel. In fact, there's a number of air races that are reminiscent of some of the prequels. And I liked the number one with the air races. I'm sorry, I know that's, purists don't like it, but I do. In any case, the most interesting aspect to this show is the Guild. And they are kind of not good, not evil. They're just very amoral. And Maestro Delphine, I guess she becomes a villain because she wants to keep everybody else down, and she's the leader of the Guild, and she wants to make sure that Anatare and Dizeth keep fighting each other forever so they don't bother the Guild. And the most interesting character is her brother, her younger brother, Dio, who is a very androgynous character. You kind of assume that he's gay because he seems to have this obsession with Klaus, but it's never really that much explained. He dresses in a very feminine manner, yet he's a very aggressive hotshot pilot. He flies these little van ships, they call them, just like Klaus and Lavi do. And so he's like a fighter pilot, and yet he's very, very feminine and very spoiled, selfish character. Interesting character arc for him. He ends up aboard the Sylvana somehow. And so the plot, though, involves Alvis, the little girl whom Klaus and Lavi rescue, and she has, for some reason, the key to these mystical artifacts called Mysteria, appropriately enough, and they are supposed to allow the people to activate the Exile. The Exile, the name of the series, which is these spaceships that are in orbit around the planet. They're supposed to allow people to go back to Earth if they feel like that. So, anyway, Alvis, for some reason, has the key. And it seemed to involve knowing these lines of poetry. You wonder why just anybody couldn't recite this poem, but it has something to do with this girl herself. So everybody wants her, everybody wants to capture her, and she's just a sweet little girl. So you really feel for her. Anyway, the original series, now, so I'm not going to give it a spoiler, but the original series was 25 episodes, broadcast back in 2003, as I said, and it was wonderful. I really enjoyed it, and I was pleased to see that there was a sequel done in 2011, another double season of 23 episodes, and it's called, the subtitle is Fam Silver Wing. And it involves a couple teenagers as its heroes, of course, again, and these are two girls, Fam, of the title, and Giselle, or Gizi. And they're, of course, cute girls. They look very young, but they're teenagers, supposedly 15. And instead of couriers, they are sky pirates. Now, I love the concept, but they're just not believable because they're too sweet. They don't carry weapons. And the teenage boys that they associate with, who also are pirates, don't seem all that threatening either. So how do they capture these ships and not have the ship's owners kill them? Another thing interesting about it is it supposedly takes place back on Earth, but it's not really Earth. But it's wherever the people from Prester originated, because they've come back. And the people that are there aren't really happy that these other people have come back. There's no place to put them, you know? But I'll maybe talk about that second season a little bit more later. But to sum up, both shows of Last Exile are original, They're very beautiful, they're complex storylines, and they're in the Dieselpunk genre, which is difficult to find, so if you're looking for that, this is one of the few places you can find it. On the bad side, they've got a number of plot holes, and there's some inconsistency, especially in the second series, about the contrast between the cuteness and the sweet, lovable characters and some of the evil, violent people who they somehow seem to have a chance against. Anyway, I would recommend it. I would recommend it with qualifications. I wouldn't really recommend it to a newbie, to somebody who's new to steampunk, but anybody who likes steampunk or is into kind of the historical sci-fi, I definitely would say you should find this online and see it. You'll definitely be able to find it. So in sum, I like to rate things with gears because this is steampunk. Gears rather than stars. Five gears is perfect. 2003 series, for its beauty and its originality and so on, I will give it 4 out of 5 gears because it does have a few flaws. 2011 series, unfortunately, slid a little bit backwards because it's just inconsistency in the unbelievability of these cute, sweet teenage girls being sky pirates. They really need to be more menacing. So that one I gave 3.5 gears. Nonetheless, if you get hooked on the Last Exile things, maybe the first season is maybe the only choice you have, other than the manga, which I have not read. So, this is Vaughn Troidy, the Steampunk Desperado, thanking you for seeing my review of the Last Exile anime here on the Steampunk Desperado channel. I urge you to subscribe and to comment and to like below and let us know what other things you might like to see in the future. Again, I thank you. And this is the Steampunk Desperado saying adios from the Steampunk Desperado channel, where the past meets the future and the present is extraordinary.